Hey, everybody. Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. On today's episode, we have an interview with the team behind the new film Honk for Jesus, Save Your Soul, writer-director Adamma Ebo and producer Adanne Ebo.
I just want to clarify some things before we get started. Every woman is not built for the great responsibility of being a first lady.
Pastor Lee Curtis Childs faces allegations of misconduct. His megachurch may never be the same.
Lee Curtis and I, we're gonna get to the other side.
Hey, you there. Yeah, with the big old microphone. Come in closer, son. You gonna see what all the fuss is about. Showtime.
What's up? Fresh is our turn, baby.
Write On's Sade Sellers chatted with the duo about making a short film first as a proof of concept for the feature, working in the mockumentary style and the challenges that come along with that, the importance of telling the stories you want to tell, and more. Check it out.
Welcome back to Write On, everyone. It's Sade here back again, and I'm so excited to kick off this new season with this great movie, Honk for Jesus, Save Your Soul. I'm here with the Ebo sisters, Adamma and Adanne, and I can't wait to actually talk about this film because I got to watch it last week and I'm obsessed with it. And it doesn't come out till September 2nd. So we're not going to do any spoilers on this episode, but we are going to talk about the process. So first I want to start with Adamma, who is the director and the writer of the film. I read a little bit about the project before joining the Zoom today, and it started out as a short, or it started out as a written feature and then a short. Which is it?
It started out as a written feature. It was the first feature I'd ever written while I was still at UCLA getting my MFA. And after writing the feature, I decided to truncate it to make it a short as a proof of concept for the feature. And so it's much more similar to the feature that's out now than the first draft of the feature that I ever wrote.
I'm really excited to talk to you about this because obviously our show is geared towards screenwriting and people who want to be screenwriters. And there's always this conversation of like, is a short worth the time? So what was the decision? I know you said you wanted to make it a proof of concept, but when did you really decide like, oh, I need to shoot this short. I need to make this a thing.
It was probably my first year at UCLA. We had Damien Chazelle and Tom Cross, the director and the editor from Whiplash, come and talk to us. And they talked about how they made Whiplash as a short, as a proof of concept, because it's, in actuality, the movie is like a thriller about jazz musicians. And you're like, what does that mean? And So they're like, it's easier to show than tell. And I knew when I knew that I wanted to do this story for Honk for Jesus and in the way that I'm doing it, I knew it was going to be a pretty tough elevator pitch. And so I was like, I need to make something to show for it. And so also being a director, it just made sense for me to write something and then also direct it.
And then Adanne, who is your sister and your twin, is that right? Twins?
Yes.
You're a producer on the feature. And what was your position on the short? Were you also producing then too?
Yeah.
Okay. So what is it like, first of all, to produce with your sister, but just to execute her vision and make sure that everything lines up the way she wants as well?
I mean, truthfully, it doesn't feel much different than our regular relationship. Honestly, in our regular relationship, we have each other's backs. We make sure that if she wants something, I try to fulfill it. If I want something, she tries to fulfill it. Like, we try to make things happen for each other. And that's essentially how we operate in our working relationship as well. So producerially, I mean, that's what producers are supposed to do. They're supposed to make sure that the director's vision comes across. And so it's like that on 10 for me. I'm like, I'm kind of like a little mini bodyguard.
Do you feel like because of the closeness of your relationship, your notes maybe are able to come off a little bit more directly than someone else who doesn't have that relationship with your sister?
100%. When we were on set shooting Honk, the rule was that I was the only one who could communicate notes directly to Adamma. Like, everyone could give notes, but they would have to give them to me.
They would have to be filtered through
me, and then I would give them to Adamma.
Wait, I love that. Why that decision? It was just because you know you can communicate to your sister better than anyone else can?
100% that. But also, I think because we had a lot of producers on this film, and there were a lot of voices. And so to be able to have one person distill all that and then translated to Adamma while we're in the chaos of being on set and production was just helpful. And Adamma and I, we communicate sometimes not even with words. So it's like I was the best person to do so. I would also say because Adanne, while I wrote this film myself, we are also writing partners. Yeah, I started writing this film before we became writing partners, mm-hmm. but we are writing partners. And so she was, you know, deeply involved in every draft of every script that I wrote. And so she knew where it came from and also where I wanted it to go in terms of story. And so, and nobody else knew the story and the vision as intimately besides myself as she did.
And then, so you both were at UCLA together at the same time?
No.
Okay.
I didn't go to film school. I went to law school. I did that whole thing.
Really? Yeah. Okay. So then what was that decision like to say, are you still practicing or did you take the bar? Did you, okay. You moved on.
I'm not practicing it. No, I, not since we both became full-time creatives in January, 2020. And okay. So that this is our job now. but before that, yeah, I was, I worked at a couple of studios working in the business affairs department at studios.
Wait, I love this so much. I want to touch briefly on your childhood and then I want to get into what happened after the short was made. Were you always creating together growing up?
You know, in hindsight, yeah. Like, well, one, we consumed story together. Like when we watched, I don't really think we really watched TV and film apart, like separately. It wasn't until maybe that we separated for grad school that we started watching things not with each other.
And we're
in fact, there are set television shows and films where feels weird to not watch it with each other.
And we won't.
And we won't. Yeah. but also we're big gamers. And even if it's like a one player game, we play it together to like pass the remote control between each other. And so, and then remember like when we were young, we would watch a movie and then we would act the movie out.
Yeah.
We would do it. You know, so
well, it would be a little different. It was like fan fiction.
Yeah.
So like we would be the characters and probably the same setting, but we like changed the story.
So
we were always creative.
In hindsight. Yeah.
Yeah. I think I might have been the only one doing like writing. Like I used to write a bunch of short stories and stuff like that.
I used to write fan fiction pretty heavy.
Oh, that's true. So
like anime fan.
Yeah. We were doing stuff. I think we just didn't realize that it could be a career in some kind of way.
Yeah.
So then, Adamma, from your point of view, when was that? You said January 2020, you became full-time creators, but when was that decision or conversation like with your sister? Like, hey, we need to be writing partners, but also let's do this together.
Well, before I graduated law school.
Before she graduated law school. It's she produced my second year film at UCLA.
Which was before Honk.
Which was before Honk the Short.
Yeah.
And I think somewhere after that, even because she couldn't be my writing partner for my thesis film because she wasn't in school with me.
Yeah.
But I think somewhere after that, the film before Honk the Short, just the way that we developed story together and I wanted to start writing television pilots, I was like, I think that we could do this together. I think we should do this together. Just the way that we like talk about story and develop, I was just like, it kind of makes sense for you to just jump in and and do the thing with me.
I love it. And then it brought us here now to the feature film. But before we touch on the feature film, I do want to just briefly wrap up the short. After the short was done and completed, what was the process to get it out there? Was it festival circuit? Was it just industry connections? Like, what was your process?
It was definitely the festival circuit. We had an entire spreadsheet about the festivals and we tiered them, or I guess I did, because
I'm
not going to look at a spreadsheet. And we had a festival strategy and the strategy was to do obviously like the more high profile festivals, but also like the very Black ones, the ones that kind of encourage like weird tones and different voices and perspectives and stuff like that. And so I think when the short played at the Black Star Film Festival, which is in Philly, that's when Issa Rae and her company saw it.
Okay.
So put the short on her YouTube. She has this YouTube series called Short Film Sundays. And then after it was on Issa's YouTube, then the short really took off.
Yeah.
Are we still able to watch the short on Instagram? Okay, cool. Okay, great. So if anyone wants to see that, I also want to ask, this subject is, I mean, like, I'm obviously I'm Black and I grew up also in the church as well, but in the Midwest, which is similar, very different from the South. Was there ever a time where anyone in your family or maybe someone you knew was like, are we really going to do this about the church? Because I know there's a very protectiveness, especially in the Black community, about our church and our pastors. Did you ever have, and I guess I'll pitched this to Adamma. Did you ever have any reservations of like, this is going to be a very controversial topic that maybe I shouldn't do?
No. I knew that it was going to be controversial. I knew it was a sensitive topic, but I knew that I was going into it, I think, in a different way than a lot of television and film has about organized religion and how things need to change and abuse of power, which is that I am of the community first and foremost. I'm not like outside looking in and passing judgment. And I also, while I'm like delivering some pretty heavy critiques, because, and I feel like I can have that critique because we know the
world.
Yeah. I also have like a deep love and reverence for it. There's the dichotomy there that I think brings a nuance that hasn't necessarily been explored before. And I think that while it is controversial, I think that that comes through. Mm-hmm. And so it's not like, I'm not damning anyone. You know what I mean? This is me saying like, we could be doing better. It comes from a place of love. People will take what they will from it, but I'm not worried about it. I've been this way my entire existence. And so my family already knows. They were just like, this is what she is. This is how
unapologetic. That's right. What I love about the feature, because I haven't seen the short yet, but I'm going to watch it after this, even though, yes, there's obviously this couple has made some mistakes, you feel so deeply for them, because you also feel, especially for Regina's character, the well-intentions and the good intentions, even if they turned into an ego and they got caught up in the fame and the stuff. But you do really feel like, especially for her, she's trying to stand by her husband and she's trying to stand up for her church. And this is, like you said, a culture, and they just can't let it go. So I felt immense empathy for them, even though they're technically the villains of the story. God, I feel bad for them. So Adanne, I want to ask, going from the shorts, all the shorts you guys did together, to a feature film, producing wise, what were the biggest, I don't want to say challenges, but maybe differences?
I think the financing component was definitely a big one. I also think just creatively bringing other people into our process was which naturally we had to do, because it's a bigger movie, which requires a bigger team. And we're used to just being in our own little silo. You know, it was something we had to shift when we were like, okay, we have to take other people's opinion besides our own. Like, it's not just us in this bubble. That was a big change for us, and learning how to navigate that, both in the development process and pre-production, on set and post-production. That was a big challenge for us, I think, like really bringing other people into the process creatively. I think you maybe did a little better with it than I did. I certainly did. Yeah, I know. There we go.
Hey there. Did you know that Right On listeners can get 40% off Final Draft 12? Visit finaldraft.com and use discount code FDPOD at checkout. That's FDPOD. Final Draft, the industry standard screenwriting software. It all starts with the script.
Adamma, to that remark, yes, there's lots of people in the process, but not only that, these are some heavyweights. Like, these are some people who have names behind them. So as a director, especially the newer director, was it like directing a Regina or a Sterling in a performance? Like, were you nervous? Were you direct? Like, what happened?
No, I wasn't nervous. And I was very direct. I think my directing style is very conversational. And so I think that probably set everyone at ease, where it's just like, it's an ongoing conversation.
It feels like a collaboration and not like
I'm the boss and you're, I think the idea, I guess even like the name director, but the idea of like, I'm directing you to do this one thing seems false in this medium, because the actors have to literally become these people. Mm-hmm. So it has to be a conversation between how you feel this person is becoming and what the person that I wrote, you know what I mean? And so I think the conversational aspect of it made it very calm and natural. Mm-hmm. And then also, I think we all just immediately really dug each other. And I felt really familial. They were very invested, not in just in the film, but in Adanne and I as like people personally. And so they just wanted to do anything and everything. And they did, because we were in the trenches. This was a low budget feature. They just wanted to do anything and everything to make sure that our vision came through. And it was amazing working with them.
What is it like to write in a mockumentary style? I've always been really interested in that. Like, I don't know if you can give us examples on the page, but how does that look? Yeah. Can you describe that?
To me, it's just, I think, a bit more camera direction in the script. Mm-hmm. Even though, like, I think ordinarily, even as a writer director, you don't necessarily, unless it's something very specific, you don't necessarily say like, you would sometimes be like, the camera slowly pushes in and stuff like that. But mm-hmm. It's not like super consistent throughout the scene. In the faux documentary format, it's like the camera pop zooms out, this camera slowly dollies in, the camera whip pans over here. You know what I mean? I think especially in this film where there are two different styles, you really want to make the distinction while reading the script when you're in one and out of one.
I think a big difference also is that the camera is also a character.
Yeah,
that's true. You write the camera as if it's a character. Mm. Like if Adamma were to write, you know, Trinity hustles down the sidewalk, it would be like the camera jostles a bit, then refocuses on Trinity and Lee Curtis. It's like the description of the camera is as if it's a character.
Yeah. Its own POV. I love that. I think that's really helpful. And then, so you had the feature written before you did the proof of concept short. Did you just dust that one off, or did you feel like, oh, I got to start over from scratch?
Oh, no, that's different from the first feature.
Yeah, I started over from scratch.
Yeah.
The first feature, I mean, the characters are the same. They have the same names.
Mm-hmm. It's similar people, and they're the same. Similar types of characters,
yeah. But I think like the core issue was very different. Mm-hmm. Like their goal was very different. I think I had them like going to like a convention, like a church convention mm-hmm. or something like that in the first feature. The title was very different.
Wait, the title was different?
Yeah. In the first.
What was the title?
It's another long, obnoxious one, but it was Love and Locusts and Leviticus and Lambs.
Wait, I really like that.
I know. I always think like I might make.
We might repurpose it.
Well, what was are you allowed to say what the decision was to switch the title up? Was it just a short?
I think because the story changed.
The story changed, and then quite frankly, I was at home and you know still like writing the short and at home in Atlanta where we're from, and I saw and people doing like. Roadside ministries is not uncommon. But I saw a guy one day and he had a sign that said, give a honk for Jesus, it may save your soul. And I remember thinking, like, huh, is that all it takes? I just got to give a little honk? But I couldn't stop thinking about it. And something just clicked. And I was like, that's the title of this movie.
Great. Oh my gosh. Thank you for the story. I didn't see that online. That's really great. Adanne, I want to ask, because we mentioned earlier about how you would filter everyone's notes on the set through you for your sister. But when it came to the script notes, what process was that? Like, I'm sure you got so many notes from so many people. So what's your advice as a producer? And then I'll ask your sister about as just a director from filtering those notes from the script and going, yes, I agree with you on this. And no, I'm pushing back on this.
I think it's all about intention and knowing Adama's intention. And I think knowing your director's intention. And I think, look, I'm a little more diplomatic than Adama tends to be. So what we do usually is that we request that we get written notes from people. Mm-hmm. For whoever's giving notes on the script, we request them to write them out. And then
we can discuss it.
Excuse me. Then she and I discuss the notes. We go note by note and discuss it.
Mm.
And then discuss our approach to how we are going to answer those notes.
Yeah. And sometimes we also do have like live conversations with the people who gave the notes. We just need them written beforehand because she doesn't like how I react to notes, which to me, I'm not super reactionary. And I think that's her issue is that I think deadpan. But it's not intentional. It's because I'm processing. I'm blank when I'm processing the notes, and I'm also trying to like problem solve in real time or answer the notes in real time. And so, but Adanne thinks it comes off very rude. So we changed up how we.
Well, I mean, that's why it's perfect. You're the yin and yang to each other to kind of balance this out. Really, you're like me and my sister. I'm also a very deadpan Adama, where I'm just like, I'm not mean. I just have a mean looking face when I am thinking.
Like, you know, if someone says something, respond. Don't just be like,
oh yes.
Just sit there. Well, they see if we're on the phone, they can't even see your face. So if they say, you know, this is what I was thinking with this note, and it's just silence. It's like
you're like, yes.
I, only have so much lie in me. And, you know, they teach you in like kindergarten. Just like, if you don't have nothing nice to say, don't say it at all. Usually if I'm non-responsive, that means I didn't like it.
Well, I want to ask you this as you're doing other, as you're doing other projects and you're writing partners now, how does that work with just notes with each other when you're going over something and one of you wants to go this way and the other wants to go that way?
Oh, I mean, we're just very direct with each other.
Yeah.
We just talk it out.
We'll literally be like, well, that doesn't make sense. Yeah. So.
We're way more direct with each other than we are with other people. So, yeah. Or we'll just be like, I don't like that.
Yeah.
And so we figure it out. It's like, what we know is that we're not going to move forward until both of us feels good about something. So right. We have to find a solution.
We have to find a solution.
We're not sugarcoating anything with each other.
So we talked about how the script had changed from the short and then to the feature and then back again now to the short. And I want to ask, like, what also changed from the script to production? Was there any moments where you got on set and you go, oh, this was written, but it's not going to work. And we need to fix it like now.
Oh, yes. So the first thing that came to mind is a scene that's not in the movie, because when we shot it, it was unusable. On set, I was like, this is unusable. And there's a scene where we have like a pedestrian walk by and like comment to the camera about what they're doing, what the first lady and the pastor are doing on the side of the road. And like, I think our actor just had a bundle of nerves. His audition was so good.
Yeah.
And then when he got on set, he could only remember like max two lines at a time.
Wow. Okay.
Like say two lines and then stop. And then say two. And then I was just like, this is, I think it was unusable. I could figure out a way to salvage this, but it was just like, it's not going to work. And so I adjusted him in real time. But even then, when we got in the edit, I was like, we can't use this.
Oh, that's unfortunate. But that happens, you know, poor actors.
Look, acting is hard. I don't know how people do it.
Right, exactly. That's why I stay behind the camera, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I have one more question to ask you both, because it's been such a pleasure talking to you. But unfortunately, my time is up. And it's something we ask everyone that comes on the show. And I'm going to give it to both of you to give your own separate answers. I feel like they'll be different. So I'll start with you, Adamma. What advice do you have to your younger writer self? If you were talking to someone 5 years ago, even 10 years ago, just about screenwriting, what advice would you give that person?
I think that, like, I would say resist the urge to conform. It wasn't a long-standing thing, but when I first got to film school, you know, there weren't a ton of Black folks, definitely not a ton of Black women. And I felt like there was this pressure from non-Black folks to tell specific types of Black stories. And it was always stories that I think was like, that were centered had some sort of proximity to whiteness. Mm-hmm. And I think I wanted to give it a shot and wasted, I think, time and energy trying to do that. You know, if you're not in any kind of box, or even if you like being in a box, like, do what your gut tells you. Don't try to conform to other people's ideas of what type of artist you are. Do your thing.
That's a great piece of advice. Adanne, for you?
I would say read as many scripts as you can. For me, that was because I didn't go to film school and I learned how to write just by working with Adamma. But before I even started working with Adamma, before we became writing partners, I just read a lot of scripts and I learned like format and structure and all that stuff from reading scripts. And so I would say, even if you don't go to school for it, even if you don't like take, you know, there are different classes you can take for it and stuff. So even if you don't go about it the institutional type of way, reading scripts will always make you a better writer.
Yeah. And I'm going to co-sign to that because I too did not go to film school and I'm self-taught just like you by reading.
Candidly, you don't got to. Film schools, you don't need it to.
For all my listeners who are in film school now, do what you want.
Finish. You're already there. Yeah, really keep good. Going.
Honestly, but, you know, keep going. Don't drop out yet.
But don't let that be a deterrent. Like, nobody asked for your degree or your transcript.
Don't. Exactly. It's all possible. Don't drop out. Don't have your parents chase us down. Thank you both for coming on the show. I really look forward to interviewing you more as your careers go along. Really love your energies. And I'm so close with my sister. So this is just feels good. Honk for Jesus Save Your Soul is out on September 2nd in theaters and on Peacock at the same time. So please go watch it. Go support it in theaters, especially if you're able and it's safe for you. Go do that. Thank you both. I had a great time and I'll see everyone next time on Write On.
Thank you so much.
Thanks again to Adamma and Adanne Ebo for coming on the show. Honk for Jesus Save Your Soul is in theaters September 2nd. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting.
This podcast is produced by Emma Vranich. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly.
Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.